Chase Kane. Yes. Professor, is it visible now?
Yeah, perfectly visible. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Then I'll stop broadcasting now.
Yeah, please do.
Right.
How many slides?
Sir, 141 slides.
Okay. That would take about 1.5 hours. Hello? 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 Should we start? Hello? Hello? Hello. Hello?
Yes, sir.
All set?
Yes, sir, all set.
So that would take you how much? One hour, 20 minutes?
Yes, sir, roughly I'll try to finish within 1 hour, 20 minutes. 15 to 20 minutes.
Take your time, no issue. So, are we good to go? Should we start? Hello? Hello?
Mobile of the present.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, something is going wrong at your end.
Yes, sir. I don't know. We do get good connection. I don't know. I am present. I hope we have. connection,
connectivity is not very good because it's just getting disconnected.
Yes, I'll just try and see.
Is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Should we start?
Yes, sir. Sure.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue. This is Pursue 25D, which is pediatric pathology. And this is a session 4. We are streaming live from Deason Hospital, Kolkata. And in this session 4 of pediatric pathology, we'll be dealing with tumor and tumor-like lesions of infancy and childhood. And to talk on that, we have once again Dr. Krishti Chatterjee. She's an MBBS from North Bengal Medical College, MD Path from the famous Medical College and Hospital, Kolkata. Presently, she's a consultant pathologist at the Deason Hospital and Heart Institute, Kolkata, with several awards in state and national level paper presentations and quiz competitions, teacher and examiner in state paramedical technical courses, publications in several journals, with areas of interest in histopathology, pediatric diseases, including hemoglobinopathies. Before I ask Dr. Krishti to start, let me request all of you to keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let me request, madam, please share your screen. Let's start.
Yes, sir. Is my screen visible?
Yeah, please make it full screen.
Yeah.
Yeah, perfectly fine.
Thank you, sir, for those kind words. As we step into a new year, that is 2022, let's hope that it will be a better one. Today's topic is the tumor and tumor-like lesions of infancy and childhood. In this talk, I would like to touch on the tumor-like conditions and common pediatric solid tumors. Leukemias and lymphomas are in themselves a huge topic and are being handled adeptly in separate talks by several eminent speakers. So essentially, I would like to cover the essentially pediatric solid tumors, for example, the retinoblastoma, hepatoblastoma, neuroblastoma, medulloblastoma, kidney tumors, rhabdomyosarcoma, and desmoblastic small round cell tumor. The tumor-like conditions mostly include the choristoma, hamartoma, hemangiomas, lymphangiomas, etc. So, heterotopia or choristoma, microscopically normal cells or tissues that are present in abnormal locations. For example, pancreatic cell nests in stomach or small intestine or nests of adrenal cells in kidney, lung or ovaries. And hamartomas are excessive focal overgrowth of cells and tissues native to the organ in which it occurs. Mature cellular elements occur, but they do not reproduce the normal architecture. For example, hemangioma, lymphangioma, rhabdomyoma, hepatic adenoma. Hemangiomas. Both capillary and cavernous hemangiomas may occur. However, in children, most are located in the skin of face and scalp and are also known as port wine stains. These are usually flat discolorations of characteristic color. These lesions may be associated with VHL syndrome and may also accompany a mutation in the CCM gene in case of familial cases. Now we move on to the solid tumors, mostly malignant and quite devastating, so requiring a prompt diagnosis. And we start with retinoblastoma. It is the most common intraocular neoplasm in children with a mutation in the RB gene on chromosome 13q14. These present with leukochoria or the white pupillary reflex or strabismus, usually within 2 years of age. Seemingly, they tend to originate from early progenitors and cone precursors and are approximately 60% are unilateral. All the bilateral cases and approximately 15% of all unilateral cases represent a heritable form of the disease occurring due to germline mutation in one allele and a somatic mutation in the second allele. However, in the sporadic disease, both the mutations are somatic. In rare cases, NMIC mutation can substitute for RB gene loss as the initiating genetic event, resulting in a more anaplastic appearing tumor. In these two figures, we can see one showing leukocoria, which is the white pupillary reflex and a mild strabismus. And in the ultrasound B mode, we can see a developing retinoblastoma. What is the third eye? Sometimes referred to as third eye or trilateral retinoblastoma, it occurs in approximately 3 to 5% of cases. It is essentially a bilateral retinoblastoma with a morphologically similar intracranial involvement, particularly of the pineal gland. So always in case of bilateral retinoblastoma, we need to look for intracranial involvement. Gross points. Genetic studies may be requested on neoplastic tissue and should be harvested prior to fixation. The surgical margin of the optic nerve should be obtained prior to opening the globe and submitted face down. The minimum recommended fixation time for whole globes with intraocular tumors is 48 hours. The globe should be fixed in an adequate volume of fixative with a 10:1 ratio of fixative volume to the specimen volume. The orientation of enucleated specimen is done by noting the position of the inferior oblique muscle relative to the optic nerve. The insertion of the inferior oblique muscle is temporal to the optic nerve. The terms temporal and nasal are generally used in place of lateral and medial with reference to ocular anatomy. The long posterior ciliary artery is often seen as a blue-gray line in the sclera on either side of optic nerve and marks the horizontal median of the globe. Sectioning the globe. The surgical margin of the optic nerve should be sectioned and submitted prior to sectioning the globe to ensure that intraocular malignant cells do not contaminate this important surgical margin. The globe is generally sectioned in the meridian that includes the largest or the most informative portion of the tumor, with care to include the pupil and optic nerve in the cassette. Each callate should also be sampled. The callates should be bread-loafed in anterior-posterior direction and submitted on edge in a separate cassette for each callate. Here we can see the sectioning where the globe is sectioned in the meridian-wise to include the pupil, tumor, optic nerve, and also the section and submit each of the callates separately and entirely. The pupil optic nerve segment should be histologically sectioned from the periphery to the center of the optic nerve along the various levels to determine the tumor extension and to evaluate if the tumor passes the lamina cribrosa and if it reaches the meninges. Involvement of the lamina cribrosa or meninges may also correlate with the MRI images. On microscopy, the tumor appears as dense masses of small round cells with hyperchromatic nuclei and scant cytoplasm, with commonly seen areas of dystrophic calcification and necrosis. Two types of rosettes, Homer-Wright with central tangle of processes and Flexner-Winterstein with true lumens, are often found. In this, we can see a full section of the pupillary optic nerve block with the tumor and other images of A, extraocular tumor, B, retinal tumor and its relation to the optic nerve, C and D, detailing the tumor in relation to the choroid and retina. Tumors with many Flexner-Winterstein rosettes accounting for more than half of the tumor are graded as moderately differentiated. What are fluorets? These are cytologically bland cells producing a bouquet of eosinophil processes, recapping the photoreceptor inner processes, could be premalignant lesion, which brings us to another entity, that is retinocytoma. It may occur at the base of the tumor. These areas are more resistant to chemotherapy and occasionally only retinocytomatous part may remain viable, which may be surrounded by calcification, gliosis, and debris from the regressed retinoblastoma, which may remain back as a scar. Tumors with retinocytomatous areas accounting for more than half of the tumor are graded as well differentiated. Tumors that show no fluorets or rosettes are graded as poorly differentiated. The nuclei of poorly differentiated tumors may show anaplasia. Rarely, unilateral retinoblastoma tumors show a loose cellular pattern with round nuclei and prominent multiple nucleoli indicating of NMIC amplification and normal RB1 allele. The growth pattern. Endophytic growth pattern indicates growth from the inner retinal surface into the vitreous cavity. Exophytic tumors grow primarily from the outer surface of the retina into the subretinal space towards the choroid. A mixed growth pattern exhibiting features of both endophytic and exophytic growth may occur. Diffuse infiltrating tumors grow laterally within the retina without significant thickening. Patterns of invasion. Small tumors initially are limited by the retinal boundaries, which are the Bruch membrane and the internal limiting membrane. As the tumor grows, it spreads into the adjacent vitreous, subretinal space, underlying choroid, optic nerve, or anterior segment, which are the iris, trabecular meshwork, or Schlemm's canal. Patterns of choroidal invasion. The presence and the extent, focal versus, of the choroidal differentiation by the tumor should be stated. Differentiation should be made between true choroidal invasion and artifactual invasion due to seeding of fresh tumor cells during post-enucleation retrieval of tumor tissue and or gross sectioning. Artifactual invasion is identified when there are groups of tumor cells present in open spaces between intraocular structures, extraocular tissues, and or subarachnoid space. True invasion is defined as one or more solid nests of tumor cells that fills or replaces the choroid and has pushing borders. Invasion of the subretinal pigment epithelium space where tumor cells are present under the retinal pigment epithelium but not beyond Bruch's membrane into the choroid is not choroidal invasion. Focal choroidal invasion is defined as a solid nest of tumor that measures less than 3 mm in maximum diameter. And massive choroidal invasion is defined as a solid tumor nest 3 mm or more in maximum diameter in contact with the underlying sclera. Invasion of the optic nerve is defined by tumor infiltrating the optic nerve in any of its portions, pre-laminar, laminar, or post-laminar, and optic nerve margin and meninges. To evaluate the optic nerve invasion, complete sections of the nerve that pass through the center, which is the central vessels present at the lamina tuberosa, should be reviewed. The exact length of the optic nerve invasion is measured vertically from the level of Bruch's membrane. Here we can see photomicrographs detailing the tumor cells involving the sclera, the choroid, and the optic nerve. Similarly, the photomicrographs demonstrate the invasion of optic nerve by the tumor cells in the pre-laminar and the laminar spaces. On electron microscopy, features of photodifferentiation can be seen. The tumor cells on immunohistochemistry are positive for synaptophysin, retinal binding protein, retinal S antigen. The proliferation index by MEB is generally high, and the cells are usually negative for CD99, GFAP, and CD45, differentiating with other small round cell tumors and lymphoproliferative disorders. On molecular analysis, loss of function mutation of RB, gain of 1Q, 2P, 6P, 13Q, amplification of NMIC, and other genes can be seen. A very small percentage have RB1 inactivated by chromotryptic event in chromosome 13. Whole genome sequencing revealed recurrent BCOR mutations in 13% of retinoblastoma. SHH signaling proteins may also be involved in certain percentage of cases. The staging is usually done as per the TNM. Next, we move on to hepatoblastoma. It is not a very common tumor in current in conventional practice, but core biopsies and liver biopsy specimens in dedicated tumors may at times pop up cases of hepatoblastoma. It is the most common primary pediatric liver tumor, mostly diagnosed within the first 3 years of life. Majority are sporadic. Associated syndromes may be with Beckwith-Wiedemann, trisomy 18, familial colonic polyposis, leaf Romani, and glycogen storage diseases types 1A, 3, and 4. The serum alpha fetoprotein may be high. However, undifferentiated tumors with low serum alpha fetoprotein may have a poor prognosis. Grossly, we get solid, well-circumscribed, solitary more often. For resection specimens, the sections should be prepared from each major tumor nodule, while representative sampling of smaller nodules if macroscopically different in appearance. And at least one section per centimeter of greatest diameter should be taken to assure the detection of areas with unfavorable histopathologic features, for example, the small cell or undifferentiated or rhabdoid areas. adequate sampling of margins, lobectomy specimen, and hilar and vena caval margins in explants is needed. While the overall prognosis is determined by several factors, adequate sampling may identify small cell undifferentiated or pleomorphic epithelial components, which may suggest more therapy-resistant clones of the tumor cells. Here we can see a specimen of liver with a gross tumor. The various morphological types can be categorized into epithelial variants and mixed epithelial and mesenchymal variants. Epithelial variants can be pure fetal or fetal, pleomorphic, embryonal, small cell undifferentiated, epithelial mixed, cholangioblastic, macrotrabecular pattern, and mixed variants are without teratoid features and with teratoid features. Coming to microscopy, 67% approximately are pure or epithelial variants, mostly with immature embryonal and fetal hepatic elements like irregular laminae of hepatocytes around 2 cells thick. A well-differentiated fetal histopathology with low mitotic count may indicate a favorable prognosis. Embryonal elements are represented by solid pattern of growth and may be with ribbons, rosettes, and papillae. And foci of extramedullary hematopoiesis with giant cells are often associated with ectopic hormone production. In case of mixed histology with additional mesenchymal components, for example, the spindle cells, the osteoid, and the cartilage may comprise 20-30%. Appearance of neuroglia, squamous elements may indicate teratoid areas, and when with low AFP may resemble malignant rhabdoid tumor. The macrotrabecular type often mimics the hepatocellular carcinoma. When tumor cells of either fetal or embryonal type show prominent nucleoli and are more atypical morphology resembling hepatocellular carcinoma, the term pleomorphic epithelial is used. A slice following partial resection of liver showing a hepatoblastoma with a gray cut surface and small areas of hemorrhages. The next micrograph shows hepatoblastoma with pure fetal histology and minimal mitotic activity. Next, we can see a hepatoblastoma of embryonal type and photomicrograph D showing a teratoid hepatoblastoma with ribbons and nephroblastoma-like tubules and acini. The other significant epithelial component that needs to be looked for is the small cell undifferentiated pattern. The more common scenario, however, is an epithelial hepatoblastoma with fetal and embryonal areas and showing aggregates of small cells. These cells have uniform, quite pale nuclei compared to surrounding darker nuclei of embryonal cells and occur in haphazard nests. The other differential is the malignant rhabdoid tumor. The rhabdoid cells have characteristic eccentric pink cytoplasmic inclusions that are PASD positive, maybe vimentin or cytokeratin positive with vesicular nuclei. These mostly occur in infancy. They may show a loss of INI1 staining and are usually associated with a poor prognosis. In both biopsy and resection specimens, the assessment of microscopic lymphovascular invasion should be restricted to the parenchyma outside of the tumor nodules. Documentation should include gross vascular invasion versus intravascular growth found only microscopically and whether it is within the tumor mass or outside of it. Evidence of vascular invasion usually has been associated with a worse outcome. Coming to the IHC, AFP is positive in fetal and embryonal and is negative in mesenchymal and undifferentiated areas. APR1 PCEA are positive in fetal component. Glypican 3 is positive in epithelial components except in poorly differentiated small cell areas and mesenchymal components. Aberrant nuclear beta-catenin staining may be seen. Almost 80% abnormalities of the WNT signaling pathways may be harbored, leading to a mutation of the beta-catenin gene and resultant abnormal nuclear translocation causing aberrant nuclear staining on IHC. And activation of TART and MYC may suggest an aggressive phenotype. Some of these tumors may show morphological evidence of pre-surgical therapy in the form of tumor necrosis, fibrohistiocytic response, osteoid formation, or may mimic non-neoplastic liver, and there may be nuclear atypia and thick trabeculae like hepatocellular carcinoma. The staging is done as per the Children's Oncology Group. It is recommended for hepatoblastomas. Staging is performed at diagnosis prior to any form of therapy. The stage 1 tumors are completely resected, margins grossly and microscopically negative for tumor. Stage 2 tumors are grossly resected with evidence of microscopic residual tumor. Stage 3 are unresectable tumors, and stage 4 tumors are those that present with measurable metastatic disease to the lungs or other organs. Another important tumor in the pediatric age group is the neuroblastoma. It includes a spectrum of tumors with varying degrees of differentiation and manifesting as neuroblastoma, ganglioneuroblastoma, ganglioneuroma. Typically diagnosed within 4 years of life, indicating a familial predilection, and may be a part of associative syndromes. For example, the Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome, or may be associated with Hirschsprung disease, neurofibromatosis type 1, and in case of Turner syndrome, there might be a component of congenital neuroblastoma. Mostly presents as abdominal mass, watery diarrhea, and several paraneoplastic syndromes, and sometimes with raised urinary catecholamines, which may be detected prior to biopsy. The abdomen is the most common primary site of neuroblastoma, with more than 76% of tumors arising either in the adrenal glands or less commonly in the paravertebral sympathetic chains. The opsoclonus myoclonus syndrome is the best example of a paraneoplastic manifestation of neuroblastoma. This is thought to occur due to cross-reactivity between a neuroblastoma antibodies and the Purkinje cells of the cerebellum. On gross, we get large, soft, gray, mostly well-circumscribed areas of hemorrhage, necrosis, calcification, and cystic degeneration may occur. When handling an excision specimen, sections should be obtained from central and peripheral areas of the tumor. At least one tumor section per centimeter in the longest dimension, and sections from all inked surgical margins should be submitted. All grossly visible nodules or hemorrhagic foci should be individually sampled. Molecular testing is crucial for accurate risk stratification and clinical decision making, so preserve tissue in case of core biopsy. Here we can see a gross appearance of a neuroblastoma. Points for untreated tumors. International neuroblastoma classification is used when describing untreated tumor samples. There are 4 specific categories in this group of tumors: neuroblastoma, Schwannian stroma 4, ganglioneuroblastoma nodular composite, Schwannian stroma rich or Schwannian stroma dominant and stroma poor, ganglioneuroblastoma intermixed, that is Schwannian stroma rich, and ganglioneuroma Schwannian stroma dominant. The International Neuroblastoma Pathology Classification System, where favorable tumor include those that are poorly differentiated or differentiating neuroblastoma with low or intermediate MKI, patient age less than or equal to 1.5 years, differentiating neuroblastoma and low MKI in patients 1.5 to 5 years, ganglioneuroblastoma intermixed regardless of age, ganglioneuroma regardless of age. Unfavorable tumors are those that are undifferentiated or high MKI in patients of any age, poorly differentiated or intermediate MKI in patients 1.5 to 5 years, any grade of differentiation and any MKI class in patients more than or equal to 5 years of age, nodular ganglioneuroblastoma regardless of age. In Schwannian stroma poor category, microscopically, tumors in the neuroblastoma category are composed of neuroblastic cells that form groups or nests separated by delicate, often incomplete stromal septa without or with limited Schwannian proliferation, comprising less than 50% of the tumor. In this case, the differentials would include pediatric small round cell tumors, for example, Ewing's PNET, which will be CD99 positive, lymphoproliferative disorders, which will be CD45 positive, alveolar rhabdomyosarcoma, which would be desmin, myogenin, and myod1 positive, Wilms tumor, which will be WT1 positive, and desmoplastic small round cell tumor, which would be positive for the C-terminal of WT1. In the photomicrograph, we can see a stroma poor neuroblastoma, which consists of densely packed small round cells with scant cytoplasm. Ganglioneuroblastoma nodular. Tumors in the ganglioneuroblastoma nodular category are composed of multiple clones. One or more nodules of neuroblastic cells set within a background of ganglioneuroblastoma intermixed or ganglioneuroma-like tissue. Schwann cells and ganglion cells are prominent in the stroma-rich neuroblastoma. Ganglioneuromatous, that is Schwannian stroma, rich component of the tumor exceeds 50%. The neuroblastic component is present in an intermixed or randomly distributed pattern of microscopic neuroblastic nests. The neuroblastic component consists of cells in various stages of differentiation, including neuroblasts, differentiating neuroblasts, maturing ganglion cells, and has a varying amount of neuropil. Macroscopic hemorrhagic nodules are absent. In the ganglioneuroma, which is Schwannian stroma dominant category, two subtypes are included. The neuroblastic cells in the tumor tissue do not form microscopic nests but are individually distributed in the Schwannian stroma. In the maturing subtype, the Schwannian stroma is predominant with minor scattered groups of differentiating neuroblasts or maturing ganglion cells along with completely mature ganglion cells. There are no islands of neuropil. In the mature subtype, the Schwannian stroma predominant with exclusively completely mature ganglion cells. May have neuritic fascicular processes accompanied by Schwann cells and perineural cells. Satellite cells may accompany mature ganglion cells. There is complete absence of a neuroblastomatous component, including no islands of neuropil. Here we can see two figures. Top one includes the maturing and the bottom one includes the mature subtypes. In the mature subtypes, we can see several mature ganglion cells. The risk stratification is important for prognostication. The risk stratification is done as per the International Neuroblastoma Classification, the mitotic karyotype index, the amplification studies of the NMIG gene, studies of the chromosomal abnormalities, and flow cytometry. The mitotic karyotype index, a count of all mitotic or karyotype figures per 1000 neuroblasts is done in an area which should be representative. The calculation is addition of mitotic and karyotype figures per neuroblasts. And the classification is MKI is considered low if it is less than 100 per 5000, which is 2%. It is intermediate if 100 to 200 per 5000, which is 2 to 4%, and high, which is more than 200 per 5000 or more than 4%. Small pycnotic nuclei are mostly angulated, crescentic with recognizable eosinophilic cytoplasm. These are karyotype figures. We should avoid confusing them with the lymphocytes. MKI averaging method should be weighed. In case of heterogeneous tumor, fields should be counted proportionally. It is usually done at 40x magnification and areas of necrosis should be better avoided. The NMIG is approximately 25% of cases. It shows an amplification. It is associated with rapid clinical progression and applies to stage 4S. It is detected by FISH or PCR. In rare case, discordance between genotype and phenotype may occur. If these tumors have bull's eye, that is prominent nucleoli, then this may indicate a poor prognosis. If NMIG is not amplified and if having deletion of 11q and 17q gain, then also it may indicate a worse prognosis. Unbalanced 11q aberration, which indicates intermediate risk group if other factors are favorable. On flow cytometry, aneuploid stem line may indicate a favorable outcome. Next, we move on to pediatric renal neoplasms. These comprise an important category. These encompass quite similar appearing tumors with patterns of histology, IHC, and specific molecular features. These are highly heterogeneous group of tumors with considerable histological overlap and are associated with several germline predispositions. IHC and molecular analysis are often adjunct to histomorphology. Three major histological patterns can be identified, which are epithelial, mesenchymal, and undifferentiated. The epithelial pattern is common to the following entities: the epithelial type of Wilms tumor, hyperplastic perilobar nephrogenic rests, papillary renal cell carcinoma, and metanephric adenoma. Epithelial Wilms tumor. The median age of presentation is 15 months and approximately 80% are stage 1. Microscopically, they consist of epithelial structures including a spectrum of nephrogenesis, poor, moderate to well-differentiated tubules and glomeruli. The tumor cells are often columnar with elongated hyperchromatic and crowded nuclei, inconspicuous nucleoli and scant cytoplasm. The mitotic figures are easily identified. The differentials of poorly differentiated tumors, which include papillary RCC and metanephric adenoma. In the photomicrograph of epithelial Wilms tumor, we can see poorly differentiated two moderate to well-differentiated components with rosette-like structures, some tubules, and well-differentiated types may present with glomerular-like or with sometimes heterologous elements. The other close mimickers are the nephrogenic breasts. These are found in more than 90% of bilateral Wilms tumor, and their identification as foci of embryonal cells persisting beyond 36 weeks of gestation favors a diagnosis of Wilms tumor. These may be perilobar. Here we can see the accumulation of the perilobar nephrogenic breasts located at the periphery of the renal lobe, or this may be intralobar. The caveat: it is difficult to differentiate hyperplastic nephrogenic breasts from Wilms tumor by even immunohistochemistry. Another close entity as a differential is the papillary renal cell carcinoma. These lack a pseudocapsule, blastemal, and stromal component. The main DD of Wilms tumor in older children, which are more than 15 years of age, is often a papillary renal cell carcinoma. The histomorphology is mostly belonging to the two different types. The type 1 consists of small cuboidal cells with scant cytoplasm arranged in a single layer on papillae, tubules, glomeruli-like structures with foamy macrophages and sarcoma bodies. The type 2 consists of papillae lined by pseudo-stratified cells, abundant eosinophilic to occasional clear cytoplasm, atypical nuclei, prominent nucleoli, and differentiating from Wilms tumor. Among the other types of renal cell carcinoma, the MIT family translocation carcinoma comprising the XP11.2 translocation and translocation 611 and harboring the TFE3 gene fusion and TFE3B gene fusions respectively are common. They have a distinct histological features, and there are some syndromes with germline predispositions to renal cell carcinoma. Metanephric adenoma, small, uniform, closely packed tubules and papilla, and how to differentiate these from Wilms tumor: the lack of pseudocapsule, sharp demarcation from renal parenchyma, and absence of atypia. A photomicrograph of metanephric adenoma showing closely packed arrangement of tubules and papilla. Coming to immunohistochemical analysis of epithelial patterned tumors, epithelial Wilms tumor, we can see strong nuclear staining for WT1. Epithelial Wilms tumor shows strong nuclear staining for WT1 and are negative for CK7. Metanephric adenoma show a strong nuclear WT1 positivity and a BRAF V600E positivity. XP11.2 tumors show on histopathology large epithelioid cells with eosinophilic cytoplasm and eosinophilic nucleoli. These show nuclear positivity for TFE3 stain and are negative for CK7. And papillary renal cell carcinoma are WT1 negative and CK7 positive. Pediatric renal tumors with a predominantly stromal or mesenchymal morphology comprise mesenchymal Wilms tumor, where a thorough sampling is essential, clear cell sarcoma of kidney, metanephric stromal tumor, congenital mesoblastic nephroma, and primary renal sarcoma or synovial sarcoma or monophasic inflammatory myofibroblastic tumor, which should be considered as a differential in case of older children. Here we can see the classic triphasic Wilms tumor, anaplastic, where the cells show diffuse anaplasia, and blastemal types of Wilms tumor. In case of the stromal type of Wilms tumor, the spindle cells are often seen arranged in bundles, fascicles, or storiform pattern. In clear cell sarcoma, histologically various patterns may exist, and approximately 90% show at least focally the classic pattern with bland ovoid cells with monomorphous nuclei, with finely dispersed chromatin, with small nucleoli and arranged in cords and nests separated by chicken wire vasculature. In very young children, congenital mesoblastic nephroma is another important consideration. It encompasses three histologic variants: classic, cellular, and mixed, containing areas of both cellular and classic histology. The classic type consists of bland spindle cells organized in an interlacing fascicular pattern embedded in collagenous stroma, blending into the pre-existent renal parenchyma with entrapment of normal renal parenchyma. The cellular type has a higher cellularity of ovoid cells with less cytoplasm, organized in solid sheets and with a higher proliferation rate and a rather clear border towards the renal parenchyma. Here we can see cellular component which resembles the infantile fibrosarcoma, and some may have vesicular nuclei and plump spindle cells. The metanephric stromal tumor is a rare tumor which histologically resembles the congenital mesoblastic nephroma but occurs at an older age. It shows some characteristic histological features including alternating cellularity, a scalloped border with the renal parenchyma, perivascular cuffing and angiodysplasia. Coming to the IHC of mesenchymal patterned tumors, the stromal type of Wilms tumor consists of spindle cells which often shows more patchy or focal staining for WT1 and they lack staining for BCL6 coreceptor or BCOR. The classical pattern of a clear cell sarcoma of the kidney has fine vasculature, which is a chicken wire type, and characteristic strong nuclear staining for BCOR as well as cyclin D1. A mixed type congenital mesoblastic nephroma with hypercellular areas resembling the cellular subtype and less cellular areas resembling the classic subtype, the IHC pattern is rather indistinct, including lack of staining for WT1 and cyclin D1. Metanephric stromal tumor showing the formation of concentric rings of stroma surrounding some of the epithelial tubules in the onion skinning pattern. The stromal component lacks the WT1 staining but retains strongly the CD34 staining. Undifferentiated pattern. Some pediatric renal tumors have an undifferentiated small round blue cell appearance, which include the blastemal component of the Wilms tumor, the rhabdoid tumors, the poorly differentiated or undifferentiated neuroblastoma, the desmoplastic small round cell tumor, Ewing sarcoma, and the lymphomas. The blastemal Wilms tumor component consists of undifferentiated small blue round cells with high cellularity of round to ovoid cells with high NC ratio and brisk mitotic activity. Blastema often shows different histologic patterns such as nodular, trabecular, diffuse and serpentine. Here we can see patterns of nodular and diffuse and serpentine. The rhabdoid tumors are aggressive, infiltrating tumors with a very poor prognosis, often presenting in patients younger than 2 years of age. These are highly cellular, non-encapsulated tumors composed of infiltrating sheets of non-cohesive cells with a large eccentric nucleus and abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm. However, they may show different patterns which sometimes lead to difficulties in achieving a correct diagnosis and routine H&E staining only. Two newly described sarcomas, very rarely seen in children, are the CICDUX4 translocation sarcoma and the BCOR-CCNB3 translocation sarcomas. Both tumors often show a spectrum of round cells to more epithelioid and spindle cells, often present at least focally. The former behave highly aggressively, often metastasizing early in the disease course. The renal medullary carcinoma and collecting duct carcinoma may show significant histologic overlap with the rhabdoid tumor. Helpful diagnostic clues are the presence of a reticular or cribriform pattern and finding of sickle cells in while dysplastic changes in the adjacent tubules and a dense inflammatory infiltrate may suggest a collecting duct carcinoma. In the undifferentiated pattern, the IHCs may be of some help, where Wilms tumor with undifferentiated blastoma shows a strong nuclear staining for INI1 as well as for WT1. Malignant rhabdoid tumors of the kidney often show large cells with large eccentric nuclei, characteristic loss of INI1 staining, and a significant percentage do not stain or stain only focally for muscle markers such as desmin. The rare desmoplastic small round cell tumors depicted highly resembles the blastemal Wilms tumor significantly with staining of the C-terminal of the WT1 but with strong retaining of INI1 and desmin in all cells. Ewing sarcoma shows INI1 staining and strong membranous CD99. When tumors are large and infiltrate the kidney, tumors such as neuroblastoma enter the differential diagnosis with a strong staining for neuroendocrine markers such as chromogranin A. Then we move on to the pediatric CNS tumors. The pediatric CNS neoplasms can be either the non-embryonal or embryonal. Among the non-embryonal, the low-grade pilocytic xanthoastroma, pylomyxoid astroma, these are the most common, mostly located in the posterior fossa. However, the medulloblastomas are far more commonly seen. The medulloblastoma is an embryonal neuroepithelial tumor arising in the cerebellum or dorsal brain stem, presenting mainly in the childhood, and consists of densely packed small round undifferentiated cells with mild to moderate nuclear pleomorphism and a high mitotic count. Medulloblastoma is the most common CNS embryonal tumor and the most common malignant tumor of childhood. Medulloblastomas are classified according to the molecular characteristics along with histopathological features. Molecular classification as per transcription, mRNA or methylome profiling has more clinical significance. The histopathological types have still been retained due to their usefulness when molecular profiling cannot be properly obtained or cannot be feasible. WNT-activated variant originates in the dorsal brainstem, and medulloblastomas correspond histologically to the WHO grade 4. The medulloblastomas are categorized into the NOS and the genetically defined, where it is WNT activated or maybe SHH activated or non-WNT or non-SHH. And histologically defined types may be classic, desmoplastic nodular with extensive nodularity and large cell or anaplastic types. In medulloblastoma NOS, it is an embryonal neural tumor that is located in the fourth ventricle or cerebellum, and the nature of biopsy tissue prevents classification of the tumor into one of the genetically or histologically defined categories of medulloblastoma. Differentials include high-grade small cell gliomas, embryonal tumor with multilayered rosettes, and atypical teratoid rhabdoid tumors. Clinical features are pertaining to the rapid rise of intracranial tension. This may spread through CSF seeding, rarely may spread to bones or lymphatics. Grossly, in the region of the cerebellar vermis, they present as pink or gray, often friable masses that fill the fourth ventricle, whereas medulloblastomas located in the cerebellar hemispheres tend to be firm and more circumscribed. On microscopy, a dominant population of undifferentiated cells with a high nuclear to cytoplasmic ratio and mitotic figures are often seen. Immunophenotypically, we see synaptophysin and new N may be focal positive in the rosettes and nodules of neurocytic differentiation. GFAP may be positive in entrapped astrocytes. In medulloblastoma with myogenic differentiation, we may see desmin positive, myogenin positive, whereas alpha SNA may be negative. And in medulloblastoma with melanocytic differentiation, HMB45 may be positive. SMARCB1 and SMARCF4 expression is retained in all medulloblastoma variants, and their loss may indicate the tumor to be an ATRT. In WNT-activated tumors, we can see these are composed of small uniform cells with round or oval nuclei that demonstrate activation of the WNT signaling pathway. Rarely, anaplastic morphology can be seen. Histologically, these are WHO grade 4 tumors. Morphology may be classic. Desmoplastic nodular is not generally seen. Nearly all medulloblastomas in the WNT-activated category show some cytoplasmic immunoreactivity for beta-catenin, but WNT-activated tumors show nuclear beta-catenin immunoreactivity in most cells, although staining can be patchy in about a quarter of cases, and prognosis is generally good. We can see uniform population of round to oval cells, and the diagnosis is mainly molecular. In SHH activated and TP53 mutant cases, either germline or somatic TP53 mutation occurs. These mostly arise from the rhombic lip neurons and are associated with amplification of GLI2, NMIC, SHH may be associated. In large cell or anaplastic morphology, chromosome 17p loss and chromothripsis may occur. Neuraxial spread often occurs and prognosis is usually poor. In medulloblastoma, SHH activated and TP53 wild type, desmoplastic nodular and medulloblastoma with extensive nodularity variants are always included. But this molecular group can also have a classic or large cell or anaplastic morphology. In IHC, GAB1 and YAP1 may be positive and prognosis is usually poor. In non-WNT or non-SHH, poorly differentiated cells and excluded from the WNT-activated and SHH-activated groups by molecular testing. Group 3 transcriptome profile is characterized by relatively high expression of MYC, and MYC amplification is overrepresented in this molecular group. Group 4 tumors are characterized by recurrent alterations in KDM6A and SNCAIP as well as in other genes. These exhibit areas of rosette formation or a palisading pattern of tumor cell nuclei. Nodule formation can occur in the absence of desmoplasia. Large cell or anaplastic tumors in the non-WNT, non-SHH molecular group generally belong to group 3. And on immunohistochemistry, these are positive for synaptophysin, beta-catenin, and cytoplasmic positivity for GAB1. Cytoplasmic positivity for beta-catenin and a negative for GAB1 and YAP1. In this collage of genetically defined subtypes, we have the tables where we can see the histological profiles along with the immunohistochemical profiles. The main antibodies used are beta-catenin, YAP1 and GAB1. In case of the histologically defined, the classic pattern shows densely packed small round undifferentiated cells with mild to moderate nuclear pleomorphism and mitosis. These lack desmoplasia and marked pleomorphism of anaplastic category and the cytoarchitecture of the large cell types. The desmoplastic nodular variant shows nodular zones and intervening poorly differentiated cells that produce collagen. The variable IHC patterns with beta-catenin and GAB1 in histologically different subtypes is seen. The other pediatric small round cell tumors. One relevant tumor is the sacrococcygeal teratoma. It may occur as benign, well-differentiated cystic lesions. In kids less than 4 months, tumors with indeterminate potential, which are the immature teratoma or malignant tumors, approximately 12%, usually admixed with another germ cell tumor component, such as endodermal sinus tumor. They present with usually 2 peaks of incidence. One occurs in less than or up to 2 years of age. The other peak is seen in the adolescence, may be associated with meningocele or spina bifida. The malignant potential of immature teratomas depends upon the amount of immature elements. Various photomicrographs are seen showing the microscopic skin lining with adnexa, microscopic GIT mucosa, microscopic pancreatic tissue, and microscopic islands of cartilage. Now we move on to the rhabdomyosarcoma, which can be pleomorphic, embryonal, alveolar, or several of the less common types. Myogenin and MyoD1 are transcription factors involved in myogenesis, thus are highly specific for rhabdomyosarcoma. Mostly affects children younger than 10 years of age, with features including a varying degree of cellularity, with alternating densely packed hypercellular areas and loosely textured myxoid areas. A mixture of poorly oriented, small undifferentiated hyperchromatic round or spindle-shaped cells and varying number of undifferentiated cells with eosinophilic cytoplasm, characteristic of rhabdomyoblasts, a matrix containing little collagen and varying amounts of myxoid material. The morphology in case of embryonal rhabdomyosarcoma is often diverse, ranging from short spindle or round cells with pale to eosinophilic cytoplasm. The intercellular space often has a mucoid or myxoid appearance. Alveolar rhabdomyosarcoma is composed of large aggregates of round or oval tumor cells that show central loss of cellular cohesion and formation of irregular alveolar spaces. The individual cellular aggregates are separated and are surrounded by dense hyalinized fibrous septa. Cells at the periphery of the alveolar spaces adhere in a single layer to the fibrous septa, while the cells at the center of the alveolar spaces are loosely arranged or are free-floating. A translocation 213 or a translocation 113 resulting in PAX3-FOXO1 or PAX7-FOXO1 fusion genes occurs in most cases. This subtype is clinically more aggressive than the embryonal variant, thus is important to identify. Microscopically, 2 different patterns may be seen. Solid sheets of uniform to high-grade round cells without extracellular mucin and the classic alveolar pattern with tumor cells attached to incomplete fibrovascular septa and loose nests. Pleomorphic rhabdomyosarcoma is composed of spindle-shaped cells arranged in a fascicular pattern with eosinophilic stringy cytoplasm. Ewing sarcoma. It is now generally accepted that Ewing sarcoma of bone, extraosseous Ewing sarcoma, PNET, and Askin tumor are histologic variants of the same tumor spectrum. As many other round cell tumors, Ewing sarcoma typically appears as solid sheets of uniform small blue round cells with minimal cytoplasm and little extracellular matrix. The tumor is classically in the diaphysis of long bones and may also involve the pelvis, ribs, as well as soft tissues. Histologically composed of sheets of small blue cells with often glycogen-containing clear cytoplasm. Homeroid rosettes may occur. Diffuse membranous expression of CD99 is characteristic for Ewing sarcoma, but not specific. Nuclear FLI1 expression is seen in most Ewing sarcoma cases with the T1122 translocation, whereas ERG immunoreactivity is seen in a small subset of cases harboring the translocation 2122. NKX2.2, a homodomain containing transcription factor that plays a critical role in neuroendocrine or glial differentiation, is a target of EWSR1 FLI1, a valuable marker for Ewing sarcoma with a sensitivity of 93% and a specificity of 89%. Immunohistochemistry for CD99, NKX2.2 and nuclear FLI1 is seen in most cases. The CIC DUX4 fusion is most frequent genetic alteration in EWSR1 FUS negative undifferentiated small round cell tumors. CIC rearranged sarcomas primarily occur in soft tissue but may rarely affect bone. These tumors may have variable CD99 immunoreactivity ranging from negative to focal and or weak and to diffuse and or strong. More recently, a new subtype of Ewing-like sarcomas has been defined by the fusion of the BCOR and CCNB3 genes. Additional fusion partners for BCOR have also been found. The BCOR rearranged sarcomas more frequently arise in bone than in soft tissue and demonstrate variable CD99 expression as other Ewing-like sarcomas. The desmoplastic small round cell tumor primarily occurs in children and young adults with a striking predilection for boys. It usually arises in the abdomen, retroperitoneum or pelvis with widespread serosal implants. The tumor is so named because of prominent stromal desmoplasia. Tumor necrosis, frequent mitosis and cystic degenerations are common. Glandular and pseudo-rosette formations may be seen. Multi-phenotypic differentiation is a distinctive feature of this tumor, thus epithelial, muscular, and neural markers may have variable immunoreactivity. The tumor is classically represented by various histologic patterns and is composed of malignant round cells with a nested pattern within a desmoplastic stroma mainly, with rosette and gland formations might be detected. Nuclear expression of WT1, the hallmark immunophenotype of DSRCT, is characteristically seen when using antibodies raised against the carboxy terminus but not the amino terminus of WT1. Detection of an EWSR1 WT1 rearrangement resulting from translocation 1122 is characteristic. Some fibrous tumors occurring in infants and children range from sparsely cellular proliferations of spindle cells like fibromatosis to richly cellular lesions indistinguishable from the fibrosarcomas in adults like congenital infantile fibrosarcoma. Microscopically, these may be poorly circumscribed, lobulated masses, small to large spindle cells in fascicles or herringbone pattern with high cellularity, nuclear atypia and pleomorphism. The translocation 1215 resulting in generation of ETV6 NTRK fusion transcript has often been described as a unique diagnostic marker. With that, I suppose we have reached to the bottom of this deep ocean of pediatric tumors, mostly the solid types. And since this is an ever-enlarging topic, the pearls are usually obtained with hard work. And finally, the take-home messages. Tumors in children comprise a varied spectrum. They're clinically more aggressive, hence requiring a rapid diagnosis. And histomorphology, immunohistochemistry, and molecular methods in sync is needed. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Very, very extensive. Must be quite tired now.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving me the opportunity to present in this forum. And I have loved working on this topic, which sometimes we have a tendency of leaving out this chapter as it is towards the fag end of general pathology, but nevertheless, the diseases are really interesting.
Yes, they are. The pleasure is all ours, Dr. Krishti. Thank you for taking the entire segment of pediatric pathology, 4 lectures back to back. Excellent. Thank you so much. Please share the PDF of these lectures so that I can upload it on the Google Drive.
Yes, sir, I will share.
I would like to invite you sometime later for maybe some other topic as well, maybe somewhere down the year.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. And thank you, everybody, for your patient hearing.
Right. Thank you so much. Take care. Bye-bye.
Yes, sir. Bye.